Welcome to this discussion about Homeland Security Directives 1 and 2 recently issued in the aftermath of the Colonial Pipeline ransomware attack. My name is Mike Falk. I'm a project manager with Burns & McDonnell. I work out of the Denver office area. And joining me this morning is Marco Ayala from our cybersecurity team within 1898 at Burns & McDonnell. And we're going to be covering these topics as they relate to Homeland Security Directive 1 and Homeland Security Directive 2. So with that brief introduction, I'm going to start with the Homeland Security Directive 1. This directive was issued by Homeland Security TSA on May 28th, just after the Colonial Pipeline ransomware attack. It is a reminder to all owner operators of their requirements to review their assets to determine if their assets meet the critical energy infrastructure guidelines within the Homeland Security guidelines documents, and a need to do that on a periodic basis. 18 months is sort of the recommended timeline for that. And this directive reminds owner operators of the need to perform that. Assets and owner operators have changed ownership. And so some companies have grown and other companies are now part of a bigger organization. And the requirements to do the criticality assessment in May involved a list of 9 criteria. That has since been changed. Marco will cover that in his discussion about Homeland Security too. But in a nutshell, 9/11 happened, as most of you know, back in 2001. In the aftermath of that, Homeland Security was created, and the initial security directives that came out of that were a post-9/11 study and commission that took place and created the guidelines that we operated under for a long, long time. And they were updated in 2018, and that led to Homeland Security reacting to the Colonial Pipeline incident and issuing Security Directive 1 on May 28th, 2021. That was quickly followed up with Security Directive 2 that was issued July 20th of 2021 and a very different looking, different feeling document. And again, Marco's gonna cover some of that approach, and it is considered security sensitive information. Owner operators were required to reply to that in acknowledging receipt. But at a very high level with Security Directive 1, to determine critical energy infrastructure, owner operators have to assess their entire gas system and apply the criteria. And some of those criteria include, does the facilities or do the pipeline systems support defense institutions? Does it support federal offices, state offices? Do they supply critical energy to different levels and amounts of customers on their system? And the criteria were 9-fold. And the criticality analysis said that if you meet any one of those 9 criteria, you are critical energy infrastructure. You would need to report that to Homeland Security. And then you take subsequent steps. And those subsequent steps would be to include and create a asset inventory of all your cyber assets so that you can then perform a security vulnerability assessment on those assets to determine if additional mitigations are needed, additional tools are needed to reduce the risk of the IT and the OT environments on the systems are at risk of being attacked. It is clear that the Colonial Pipeline system was attacked on the IT level, but a lot of operators are increasingly anxious about the risk of an attack on their OT, which would include their SCADA systems and their servers and their gas control units and all of the field devices in the field and those communications pathways, which includes a lot of cell phone networks. So Security Directive 1 is a very good reminder to all owner operators to review their systems, to begin that criticality analysis. Those were supposed to be completed by December 27th of 2021 this year. But as Marco is going to point out in Security Directive 2, there are some different timelines. With that, I'm going to ask Marco to step up and talk about Security Directive 2. And Marco, you have the platform.
Thank you, Mike. Really appreciate that. Yes, you know, with the Security Directive 2 that has come out, you know, we could really only talk about it from a high level standpoint, since it is sensitive in nature and marked accordingly. What we can say is, you know, as Mike was pointing out, that the timelines have been set in place. So this, as far as the knowledge of the dates and the times and stuff like that, that is under SSI. But as far as compliance, meeting those 180 days, 90 day type statuses are set in place. And so there are companies that meet the criteria, as Mike was talking about, and that need to be able to show evidence that they are migrating and moving to meet the intent of the actual directive. And so what we've seen from a cybersecurity standpoint is that a lot of this is not new. A lot of this is from general security practices, due diligence, defense in depth, network segmentation, as Mike said, identifying your assets that you have within the actual pipeline segments. That sounds easy, but it is a task. It is a daunting task. You have to really take time and effort and really make sure that you've identified as much as you can. But keep in mind that the directives, since the very get-go from Security Directive 1, had talked about the NIST cybersecurity framework, also referenced the pipeline security guidelines that really point to the NIST cybersecurity framework. For example, the identify, protect, detect, respond, recover are key elements of even the Security Directive 2. And that's just common sense and common knowledge. So what I will say is that there is going to be some challenges that the asset owners are going to deal with, from technology that could be legacy that may not meet the regulatory pieces that are in the Security Directive. And so there could be some cost associated with that. So again, the timeline is already ticking, as Mike said, that you have to really get out there and understand what systems you have and address a lot of things that are in Security Directive 2. I cannot go into the full details of it, but what I can say is that the companies that have started it or that already have a lot of these practices in place that are more mature are probably going to be able to meet the directive quickly. But there are going to be instances where people just don't know where to start. So I think the big piece here is understanding your technology, especially the operations technology side. You know, pipeline operations, SCADA, the control system side of it, compressor stations, leak detection systems, these are all part of the critical infrastructure. And so you really have to make sure that you capture all of it to meet the intent of the directive. And Mike, I think you've brought up some other compelling pieces to being able to say, where do we start identifying what is critical? I think you'd mentioned the nine requirements or nine things to meet. So with that being said, I think the big piece there is going in, identifying, phasing the approach to meet the directive dates, and being able to identify everything that you have and document what protective measures you have in place, or provide yourself or get a roadmap of where you need to be and start now. Don't wait. A lot of this can be done at very little cost as far as the recommendations and requirements. And the things that do cost can be set and strategically placed to where you could deploy this out with accuracy and with it being feasible to meet. So those are some of the things that I can speak of from a high level. I know that from a assessment standpoint, TSA is staffing up. They are limited on resources, so there's going to be some training. There's a lot of things that are going to need to be in place for this to be at least both sides from TSA and from the owner operator side to be able to equate to meeting the intent and to be able to assess it. So I guess my point there is, from a security standpoint, is start now, identify your risks, and really create a roadmap to meet the intent of the directive. And with that, Mike, I think I'd like to go ahead